But it is related in a sense, because the conference is mainly concentrated on various random structures. But this will be about quasi-periodic matrix, which is sort of a transition between deterministic things and random things. So I think it's sort of relevant in this sense. This will be the most well-known quasi-periodic operator because it's the simplest one, and it models electron on a two-dimensional square lattice in perpendicular magnetic field. So it's sort of lattice potential and magnetic field on top of it. And that creates possibility for quasi-periodic phenomena. Okay, so this is the so we just look at this the following operator. So this is H as an operator on L2 of Z. It's sort of given by the following expression. Two lambda cosine. Okay, so this is a okay. So as I said, it models 2D electron so on a square lattice. In perpendicular magnetic field. So the parameter alpha comes from the magnetic field, and the parameter lambda is the Hopping parameter on the lattice. So if lambda is equal to 1, we have uniform lattice, square lattice, and if it's not, one, then one direction is preferable to the another direction. Okay, so this leads to some interesting phenomenon, this competition between magnetic field and the lattice. So namely, we would like to ask a question, what is the spectrum of this operator, how it looks like? And then we observe the following, that for irrational alpha, we have following cases. So first, lambda larger than 1. Then it turns out that this corresponds to the so-called localization. Which means that the spectrum is a pure point. A pure point spectrum. With exponentially decreasing eigenfunctions. And this is true for almost every alpha and theta, so, but not for all. So if lambda equals 1, we have a so-called critical regime. So here we have a singular continuous spectrum. This also, as I said, lambda equals 1 corresponds to the uniform lattice. Lattice where these interactions in both directions are the same. Sort of, this is the most interesting, therefore, case, I think. Okay, and lambda less than 1, so lambda between 0 and 1. So this is a delocalization. Delocalization, it corresponds to absolutely continuous spectrum for all alpha and theta. So this is kind of understandable in a sense that if lambda is very large, then this part dominates, and so it's obviously pure point. And if lambda is zero, it is sort of a cosine as an eigenfunction, so it's like absolutely continuous. But the transition is exactly at the point lambda equals 1. in this sense. Okay, so but this is so the next thing is that we will be so I will be kind of explaining you what happens to the spectrum as a set. So we'll just look at the spectrum of H. So we will denote it simply sigma of H. So as a set. This bounded set on the real line, and so how does it look like, right? So first of all, if alpha is rational, then it is a standard result for periodic operators that it consists of q intervals. So p over q theta is q intervals. General, they can touch, but in this case, they normally don't touch. So if alpha is irrational, I will just so far remark that this sigma of H alpha theta is independent of the phase theta. Yes, and in fact, looking back here, physically significant is not the spectrum, not this spectrum, but rather the union of all setas, because the proper parameters are alpha, lambda, and this is a kind of a auxiliary. So we would like to be very interested in the union of all over theta. But for alpha irrational, doesn't matter, because it is, as I said, it does not depend. Sort of just ergodicity property of this, of the thing. Okay. So we will also denote the Lebesgue measure of this set in the following way. Right. So now we can formulate a theorem, so which says that for all irrational alpha real theta and lambda not equal to zero, the spectrum is a Cantor set. Of measure or 1 minus lambda. 1 minus lambda. 4 times 1 minus lambda. Actually, we can restrict our attention to positive lambda because it's very simple transformation relating positive and negative lambda. Okay, so so this theorem has a very, very long history. It started somewhere in the 60s already, I think, in the 60s. And so now this kind of, it used to be known as conjecture. So the measure conjecture, it used to be called Aubrey and Andre. Conjecture. And the Cantor set conjecture became known as a 10-Martini problem. Because 10-Martini was apparently offered by Mark Katz for anybody who could solve this conjecture. And Barry Simon then propagated this name. And so it became, now it's sort of called 10-Martini problem. Hiller problem, and now I will give you some history of the proof of this. Some history of the proof. Okay, but first I would like to make a kind of a note for the critical case. If lambda is equal to 1, so then the Lebesgue measure is 0. And it follows from here immediately that the spectrum is a contrast set. So so that contrast set. Because a contrast set by definition is a closed Nova dense set without oscillated points. Absence of oscillated points for this kind of from this general ergodic series can be deduced. And any spectrum is, of course, closed. And the only thing which remains is it's nowhere dense. So basically, the statement is that it is nowhere dense. OK. So, and if it's measure zero, then immediately it's clear that it's nowhere dense. Otherwise, it cannot be zero. Okay, so, but if lambda is not equal to 1, then it is not clear because it's positive measure, so it can be a contrast set, it may not, and can happen. Okay, so the history of the proofs. Maybe one of the first rigorous results was to show that the sigma is a contrast set. For a dense set of pairs, lambda alpha. It was done by Belisard and Simon. I think it was 1982, like this. Okay, so then it was shown. The next, that sigma is a contrast set. For alphas, which are very quickly approximable by rational approximations. So I call them sort of vaguely Liouvillean alpha. So for alpha, they have a measure zero. Typically, this is which are proximal by rationals faster than exponentially quickly, fast. So, so, right. So, this was done by Choi, Elliott, and Yui. In 1990, it was very kind of important development. Okay, so then there were some works on the continuity of the spectrum, but the spectrum of irrational is approximated by spectrum of rational approximates. From here, it came a very nice result that sigma. That the measure of the sigma, get a measure of sigma, is equal 4 minus lambda for almost every alpha. And I can be even more precise and say which alpha. Actually, such that the limit when you approximate by the rational approximates your alpha, so then this limit should be zero. So these are the irrationals which have coefficients of a continued fraction expansion from an unbounded sequence, and they form a set of full measure. And for that, Last proved this formula. So in 1993, 94, here's the two papers. So in particular, if lambda is 1 minus lambda, yeah. If lambda equals 1, then it follows that it's a zero measure. Okay, but then there was a problem in his proof because not in the proof, but he couldn't prove it for all alpha because they didn't have enough strong enough continuity for the spectrum, and so that remained for a while unsolved. That's how I started with this. It's not started, but then we in our paper with Lana Zhytomyrskaya, we actually could show that this the measure is given by this formula for lambda not equal to one, like this. And all irrational in all irrational alpha. So this is our paper was. In 2002, I think it was done. Okay, so yes. So that then we use the fact that in sort of supercritical regime we have exponentially decreasing eigenfunctions, so that allowed us to improve continuity. Okay, but then it wasn't clear how to do it for the case for the critical case, first of all, and then it wasn't clear how to answer the question about the contrastructure. And here the next step was to show that that sigma for lambda not equal one is indeed a contrast set. For some Diophantine irrationals. So this is done by Pusch in 2004, I think. Yes. So these Diophantine irrationals are those which are poorly approximated by rationals. For example, the golden mean is a standard representation, standard irrational of this type. But it's, so they form this form a set of measure zero. Okay, so. So then, and still it didn't cover the case lambda equals one. So then the fact that the measure of this sigma is equal to zero for lambda equals one and all irrational alpha. Irrational alpha. So it was done in the work of Avila and Grigorian in 2006. I think. So here it has some significance for the continuation of the talk. So sort of here they used the theory of dynamical systems in some sense. So dynamical systems. This it is a rather long paper, I think 30 pages, 40 pages maybe. So to extend the result of last to Diophantine alpha. So the argument works therefore for Diophantine alpha, so together with this kind of result of last, it settles the case of lambda equals one. And so what remains here is just to show that it is a contrast set for the rest of irrational alphas when it is not equal to one, right? So then it will be, and this was completed that sigma for lambda not equal to one is contrast set for all rational alpha. So, and this was a joint work of Avila and Zhytomyrska. In 2009, I think it's. Okay, so this is a brief history of the proof of this property. So now, so we have now a new work with Svetlana, where we found a much easier argument for the critical case. So that I would like to present a little bit. So from now on, we consider only the case lambda equals 1. Everything which I will be telling you from now on will be about lambda equals 1. Kind of remove here lambda. Okay, so. So, and in fact, what we do that in this case, we actually give two elementary proofs. Of the theorem, for this case, lambda equals 1. So namely, so we show that sigma, absolute value of sigma is equal to, so measure of sigma is 0 for all irrational alpha. And so our argument work at the same time for all irrational alphas. So rather than separating, it actually works. So argument works. Irrational alpha. And so the idea of the proof is just to use a special unitary transformation, which transforms this operator in a different form. And this kind of utilizes the fact that the problem is two-dimensional, and you can write the magnetic field in different gauges. And this is sort of corresponds to the change of the gauge of magnetic field. But we will write a couple of moments later on the new representation. Okay, but so what new can we do? This is kind of reproof of the known result, but we could also prove something new. And it's also an interesting interesting question. It has also a long history from the 80s. And so the question, because it was conjectured for a long time that for this critical case, the spectrum is has a zero measure. So the natural question, of course, is what is this set? How can you characterize this set? And the most obvious question is, what is the Hausdorff dimension of the set, right? So question. What is Hausdorff dimension? Of the sigma. Okay, so here I will remind you about just the definition of the Hausdorff dimension to make it more clear. So first we define a so-called Hausdorff measure corresponding to parameter T of a set A. So A is a subset of the real line. So we define measure in the following way. So it's a limit when delta tends to 0 of the infimum of the sums at value t. So A is covered by these intervals. And this is a delta cover. You take an infimum of all delta covers, and then you take the limit when delta tends to zero. And so what is a delta cover? It's just that here, these are the intervals of length less or equal than delta. Okay. So if you look at this object, you'll see that very often it will be either a zero or infinity. And in fact, if t is very small, then it will be infinity. And if t is close to one, it may be zero. And so there is a certain point where it switches from zero to infinity, and this point is known as the Hausdorff dimension. So Hausdorff dimension of the set can be written as an infimum over t such that this Hausdorff measure is finite. At some point it will start becoming infinite, and this is a right. So if we have a set on the real line, this dimension will be somewhere between 0, 0, and 1. 0 and 1. All right? So this is the question. So now, so Thouless in 1980s. So by numerical computations, so observed, what does he observe? That actually measure of the spectrum in the rational case, P over Q. And union over all thetas, this measures. It behaves as some constant divided by Q when as alpha is as P over Q approaches alpha, some irrational alpha. So it is rather small. And this led him, of course, to the conjecture again that it is, which was slightly earlier, that it is kind of zero, that for alpha irrationality is a zero measure. But of course, you know, there is a question of proving that and a question of proving continuity. And there are two questions. So if we assume that if all intervals are of the same size, if all Q intervals of the spectrum of this rational operator so were of same size, which is in reality not so, but if they were all at the same size, the size of one would be so is some constant over qn squared or q squared. There are q of them. Q squared. And so this suggests that the Hausdorff dimension is 1/2. Because if you take it to the power 1/2 and multiply by Q the number of integrals, it will be a finite number. And if you take something larger than 1/2, then it will be small, so currently zero, and smaller, it will be infinity, or it will be something. It will be something growing with Q. Right? So sort of intuitively, it would follow that so one conjectures that Hausdorff dimension of this sigma is 1/2 for irrational alpha. So this is unfortunately is not true in general. It may still be true in some sense, maybe for almost all, but in general it is not true because there are exceptional cases. So so they exist Liouvillean alpha, such that this Hausdorff dimension is actually zero. It's a very, very thin set. So this was shown by Last and Shamis rather recently in 16. But on the other hand, it is also known that they exist. Some Diophantine alpha, such that this dimension is positive. Positive. So this was done in the work of Elfer with collaborators. I think you and Joe, if I'm not, I might miss a name here. Okay, so in principle, we have this a little bit mixed picture. On the other hand, it was shown by Last that that actually for some Diophantine alpha, this dimension is less or equal than 1/2. That was done by Last in 1994. Okay, so there is also a conjecture apparently due to Bélissard that actually it should be the same number for almost all irrational alphas. Okay, but what did we prove there here is that we prove the following theorem. So we say that for all irrational alphas, a real theta, so this dimension, sigma, is actually less or equal than 1/2 for all irrationals. Yes. So, as I said, we do not expect it to be equal to 1/2. It might be that it is equal to a certain number less than 1/2 or equal to 1/2 for almost all. So that would be reasonable. Okay, so now maybe I will give you the main element of the proof, because there are several elements. I'll give you the one which sort of gave us the right idea of how to proceed. So proof is the following. So we know that there exists a unitary transformation which is explicit that shows the following, that the union of the spectrum of H 2 alpha theta is equal than the union of a set of spectrum of H with hat, alpha theta, where the operator with hat acts the following way. So it gives you two sine to pi alpha n minus 1 plus theta times phi of n minus 1 plus 2 sine 2 pi alpha n plus theta times phi of n plus 1. And that's it. There is no diagonal. There is no diagonal term. And so why? So this, first of all, physically, this corresponds to the change of the gauge of magnetic field. So it sort of utilizes the two-dimensional structure of the model. And why is it good? It is good because sometimes this objects become very small. For some n, this becomes very, very small sometimes. And here there is no chance because it's 1 and 1 here. So off-diagonal elements sometimes become very small. And so if you look at this matrix like this, for example, this is small. And this is symmetrically small. And if this is very small, you can see that it practically splits into finite dimensional blocks. So since of diagonal elements. Can be small. So this H hat sort of, let's say, quasi separates. The blocks. So which allows to obtain a better continuity statement for the spectrum. So which allows to improve a continuity result on the spectrum. So a result on the spectrum. On the spectrum as HP over Q sort of approximates H alpha. And from here, after this statement is improved sufficiently, one can use the argument used by Last before, in 1994. So, and from here, so the result follows basically from here. The fact that absolute value, that measure is zero and dimension sigma one, less than or equal 1/2 follows. So in fact, I should say that this is much easier statement, measure zero. For that, only a tiny improvement of continuity was sufficient. But in order to prove this, it's a much stronger improvement of continuity. Yes, so this is a. I think should I finish already or I have? So maybe I just tell you what about this continuity a little bit because it sounds a bit mysterious. So yes. So for that, I just tell you how Last obtained his result. So Last found that. for a rational case, for the rational case, the spectrum, the union over theta, is between something bounded some constant over q, some other constant over q is explicit constants, something like 8 times e, some pi times something in this constant. So which combined with the which is combined then with continuity statement. Following that, for every point in the spectrum of the alpha irrational, there exists a point E prime in the spectrum of rational approximate, really union over theta, such that the distance between E and E prime is less than some constant times the square root alpha minus p over q. That is a continuity statement which was obtained by Simon van Mosch and Avron previously. So what it means is that, so suppose you have the your points of the spectrum of your presumable Cantor set of irrational situation, irrational H alpha. And so it says that they cannot be very far away from the intervals of the rational approximate. So if we have intervals of rational approximate, it must be somewhere over here. And this boundary where they can deviate, the size of this deviation is of order square root alpha minus p over q. This is what it says, simply. And so then it gives a simple bound for the measure. So sigma of H alpha, then, is bounded by sigma of HP over Q, union over theta, absolute, yes, over union over theta. This. Plus the error. What is the error? The error is this interval times the number of ages. The q interval, 2q ages. So it's 2q, some constant, and the root alpha minus p over q. And that is it, because this thing he showed is 1 over q. So it, if you increase q, it becomes smaller and smaller. And this thing will tend to zero as p over q tends to alpha and q increases for almost every alpha. That's why I wrote your condition before, but not for all. So in other words, the right-hand side of this inequality can be made arbitrarily small, from which it follows that the measure, this one should be zero. So it then follows that the measure is zero. So this is the so it follows that measure of sigma of alpha theta is actually zero for almost every alpha. So this is an argument of Last. For the Hausdorff dimension, one can use a bit somewhat similar construction. Okay. So if we can improve this, then of course we will have that it will be true for all alpha. Because even a slight improvement of this root, if it's 1/2 plus epsilon, this is then true for all irrationals. All rationals. And so, but we show that often certain sense. Often, we have this e minus e prime less or equal some constant, and the first power of alpha minus p over q slightly worse with some logarithmic badness here, like this. Yes, not for all points, but and not for all thetas, but often. And so that, of course, immediately sort of, if q is multiplied by absolute value, that it is goes to zero for all irrationals. And also, it allows us to have this continuity to Hausdorff dimension statement as well, this continuity. And this continuity we could only obtain because we had this nice structure of the matrix, with matrix elements being very small, which means that you can, so technically here you need to cut off the test function, and it is very nice to cut off exactly at this point where, you know, it has a very little error. Because in a previous representation, it wouldn't matter, it's always one. So this. Okay, so that's why so it works. Okay, thank you very much.